Hello everyone. Today it's a great honor for us to have Dr. Shaima Mustafa with us, who is working as an assistant professor at the Benha University in Egypt, who has been contributing to the field of cardiology since a long time and in a very effective way. Dr. Mustafa's interests include arrhythmias, cardiology, and cardiovascular imaging as well. So it's really a great opportunity to hear from Dr. Mustafa to understand the situation about the critical care of the patients who are infected and diagnosed with the COVID-19 or corona patients. Thank you so much, Dr. Mustafa, for joining, and over to you now.
Thank you, Dr. Naren, for this chance to join you this meeting. My first time to join meeting online due to the current situation of coronavirus. Thank you so much.
Our pleasure indeed. Thank you.
Should I start?
Yes, please.
Okay. We will discuss the critical care of patients with COVID-19. I am Dr. Shaima Ahmed Mustafa, Assistant Professor of Cardiovascular Medicine, Benha University, Egypt. We will discuss today two main points about coronavirus. We will take a rapid overview of symptoms and complications, and then we shift to management, supportive, and medical. Coronavirus is a new strain that has not been previously identified in humans. And we can see that this virus rapidly progresses within less than 4 months from just virus isolation early in this year, epidemic in Wuhan, China, to pandemic all over the world, with over then 2 million cases of viral infection and more than 100,000 of patients with mortality. The main symptoms of coronavirus are fever, cough, fatigue, and dyspnea. There are less common symptoms. The patient may complain as malaise, chill, dizziness, headache, sore throat, nausea, vomiting, diarrhea, nasal congestion. We can see there is no specific symptom or sign that is specific for coronavirus infection. And there is a common overlap and similarity between its symptoms and common cold and the flu. But the main difference between them is the disease course and progression, which may come as common symptoms, flu-like symptoms, severe cases of dyspnea, chest pain, hemolysis, crackles, and respiratory insufficiency, and they present in the form of severe complication, pneumonia, respiratory distress syndrome, cardiac injury, arrhythmia, septic shock, liver dysfunction, acute kidney injury, and may present with multi-organ failure. A recent study, of course, all these studies are recent, from January to March or April this year. There is a good correlation between, our relationship between viral load and severity of disease. Most of data about coronavirus came from previous experience with similar influenza or flu-like symptoms that was caused by a highly virulent strains of virus, as SARS, MERS, and COVID-19. Management of such patients need integration between medical staff, infection control, local health authorities, Center for Disease Control and Prevention, and the most important point is the public education. This is a new disease and its course is unpredictable. We don't know the patient will be with just flu-like symptoms, will come with severe symptoms, or will present with complication. So a heart-lung transplantation published a paper about clinical therapeutic staging proposal. This proposal divided the patient into two phases, the viral, how it behaves in the human body, into two phases, three stages. Stage one, a phase of viral response and the phase of inflammatory response. The first phase of viral response It is the phase of multiplication of the virus, introduction, multiplication, and its early manifestation in the patient. Usually, the patient in this phase is clinically stable and can, if it is stayed in this stage, it will be a good recovery for the patient. The second phase is the inflammatory response phase. Inflammatory response phase, as they call, it is a storm of inflammatory mediators. A patient classified divided into three stages. Stage one, early infection. A stage of multiplication and introduction. And here a patient can present with flu-like symptoms, with fever, dry cough, diarrhea, headache, constitutional symptoms. A lab investigation include, I can do CBC. You can see lymphopenia, increased prothrombin time, increased D-dimer, and LDH mild increase. Phase two, pulmonary phase, divided into two stages, 2A and 2B. The main difference between them is the development of hypoxemia. During this course, the patient may manifest with dyspnea and hypoxia. Clinical signs here include the patient will present with abnormal chest imaging, either in CT with normal bronchocalcitonin. The last stage, which is the worst stage for the patient, where he manifests with complication, respiratory distress syndrome, shock, and heart failure. Here, there is, as I have said already, a storm of inflammatory mediators, increased the C-reactive protein, lactate dehydrogenase, interleukin, D-dimer, troponin, and BNP. A clinical therapeutic staging proposal for this scientific research paper divided the patient into these three stages, and stage two is divided into two stages, A and B. We can see in stage one, patient present with flu-like symptoms, and so the treatment will focus on symptomatic relief. Antiviral therapy may be beneficial, and the patient who keep the virus limited to this stage, prognosis and recovery is excellent. Stage 2A, supportive measure and available antivirus therapy, but corticosteroid should be avoided during this stage. Stage 2B, anti-inflammatory therapy can be added, that is corticosteroids. And stage 3, which is the worst, immune modulation to reduce the inflammation before it is overwhelming into multi-organ dysfunction. So the most important point is to interfere with the appropriate therapy at the appropriate stage of the disease. And this explains heterogeneity of the effect of drug therapy. We will see in the next slides that there's heterogeneity between evidence. Is this drug is effective or not? The point is when this drug was taken. It is in stage two, stage three, where the most of drugs are ineffective during stage three. The most important point here about our presentation, critical care, is to when to transfer the patient to the ICU. The most important when take care of patient with coronavirus infection is to follow up and the close monitoring of the patient. And this study involved 600 patients with coronavirus, and they put early warning system, include age, lymphocyte, oxygen inhalation, and CT scan with lung infiltrate. And they divided the patient according to these four criteria into high risk and low risk. If the patient high risk, this patient need continuous monitoring. And if the patient is low risk, screening twice every day. And they choose three parameters for evaluation of the patient. If the respiratory rate become more than 30 per minute, oxygen saturation on room air less than 93%, and heart rate more than 120 beats per minute, the patient should be transferred to the clinical critical care management. This early warning symptom system has good sensitivity, good specificity, and the area under the curve was 0.9. So patients who underwent this warning system, they were discovered early and transferred early before there is overwhelming multi-organ failure. And so the management was, of course, easier than a patient in the stage three where there is multi-organ failure, either cardiac dysfunction, liver dysfunction, and kidney dysfunction. Critical care management of this patient in this scientific paper includes the high flow nasal cannulation, restrictive flow restriction, and the prone position with alveolar collapse. And is the patient condition elevation, the patient can be transferred again to the isolation room. And if no elevation, invasive mechanical ventilation will be planned for. Grading for oxygen perspective, oxygen by nasal branch up to maximum of 6 liters per minute. If fail, non-rebreather mask with filter at flow rate up to 20 liters per minute. And if fail, high flow nasal oxygen more than 6 liters per minute therapy or non-invasive ventilation include different modalities can be recommended. What is the optimum therapy for patients with respiratory viral infection with COVID-19? Optimized supportive care remains the ministry of therapy. Supportive care, as other therapies have been tested and undergoing clinical trials up now, as anti-inflammatory, antiviral, immune modulation, but optimized supportive care remains the mainstay of therapy. Antiviral therapy, there is no antiviral therapy of proven effect for other respiratory viral infection. As I have said before, that most clinical trials and most of the experience, especially from Far East, come from previous experience with SARS and MERS. When antiviral therapy combined with interferon alpha in hospitalized patients with a coronavirus are currently in progress. Most of the studies have been registered in clinical trial registration system, but most of them are still in progress. Corticosteroid in a study of patients hospitalized with respiratory viral infection, about 50 patients, corticosteroid therapy was not associated with significant difference in peak viral load duration of respiratory system infection, nasal cytokines or lymphocyte subset, although antibodies response to respiratory viral infection was slightly blunted. As I have said before, that corticosteroid should be as midline of therapy in stage 2B, when the patient with pulmonary symptoms and hypoxemia, the patient is about to develop stage 3, we can this stage interfere with corticosteroid. Cyclooxygenase 2 inhibitor, cyclooxygenase 2 may modulate excessive pro-inflammatory response in severe respiratory viral infection. And the result from randomized controlled trials, about 120 patients showed that combination of cyclooxygenase 2 inhibitors with antiviral drug reduced mortality, cytokine level, also no change in viral itch in hospitalized patient without increased adverse effect. Of course, this study was not on COVID patient. It was H3N2 patient. As I have said, most trials come from similar viral infection with similar manifestation, and it was also epidemic, but not pandemic. Sirolimus drugs, which can modulate inflammatory response through its immunosuppressive properties, it was examined in a small randomized controlled trial and treatment compared with patients without it with influenza H1N1 pneumonia receiving invasive mechanical ventilation. There were improvement in hypoxemia, multiple organ dysfunction, and virus clearance, and in shorter duration of mechanical ventilation. But of course, further studies are needed for its effect, and it is already registered in China. Statin therapy, of course, we as the cardiovascular physicians, we use statins due to its bilirubin effect, from its anti-inflammatory effect. And of course, as we have said, that there's a storm of inflammatory mediators. So it was planned to use the statin as anti-inflammatory. And it has been proposed as adjunctive therapy in COVID-19. Up till now, there is no meta-analysis about it, about its effect, but secondary analysis of data from randomized controlled trials suggested that patients with respiratory distress syndrome may be classified into hyperinflammatory and hypoinflammatory, and treatment with simvastatin compared to placebo was associated with improved survival in patients with hyperinflammatory phase. Vitamin C, citrus oil trial demonstrated that 96-hour infusion of vitamin C compared with placebo in a relatively small number of patients with sepsis and respiratory distress syndrome, although didn't improve a primary outcome of organ dysfunction score or alter markers of inflammation or vascular injury, but mortality was, which was one of 46 pre-specified secondary endpoints, were significantly lower with vitamin C. Another drug which already examined in Egypt and studied in Egyptian patient with the COVID-19 is hydroxychloroquine, which is non-antimalarial drugs, has been extensively studied and give promising result. Despite this sample of patients was small, but this is significantly associated with viral load reduction or even disappearance in its patient, and its effect is reinforced by azithromycin. The main limitation of hydroxychloroquine with azithromycin is its effect on the heart. And it was found that it makes long QT interval and may be exposed to either cerebral or ventricular arrhythmia. So hydroxychloroquine is still under study for its effect and complication. Recommendation for acute resuscitation of adults with COVID-19 when the patient in the ICU. There are different medications we can give, but there is recommendation for what to use and when to use and limit of its use. So I will summarize these recommendations for acute resuscitation of this patient using conservative open liberal flow strategy. Fluid, it was found that fluid intake when it is conservative will decrease the pulmonary edema the patient can present with, decrease the duration of mechanical ventilation, and decrease the duration of ICU period of the patient. The use of crystalloid was preferred over colloids, and balanced or buffered crystalloid over non-balanced crystalloid. If the patient needs vasoactive agent, nor epinephrine in the first-line vasoactive agent. And titrating vasoactive agent to target mean arterial pressure of 60 to 65 millimeter mercury rather than higher mean arterial pressure target. If the patient in refractory shock, we suggest use of low dose corticosteroid. This is a shock reversal over no corticosteroid therapy. Starting supplementary oxygen if peripheral oxygen saturation less than 90. This is a point of controversy between studies. To start if oxygen saturation less than 90 or less than 92. But they agree to maintain a higher, not higher than 96. Close monitoring for worsening of respiratory status and early intubation in controlled setting if worsening occurs. With intubation, we need low tidal volume ventilation from 4 to 8 milliliters per kilogram over higher tidal volume to avoid ventilation-induced lung injury. Every management strategy has its own complications. Currently, there is no FDA-approved treatment for COVID-19, although number of drugs are under investigation. We have common statement here in Egypt that protection is better than management. So our certain way to decrease spreading infection, it is well better be a patient or intubated or admitted to the ICU. So avoid touch your ear, nose, mouth without washed hands, avoid the close contact with sick people, avoid eating uncooked or raw meats, avoid travel, and don't be in crowded places. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Dr. Mustafa, for really giving us a very comprehensive overview of the COVID-19 patients and the problems with which they suffer. And I must confess that this talk has been really enhancing my knowledge and deeper insights about such patients as well. You were able to explain to us in a very nice way about the different criteria for the critical care admission of a patient, and also those most popular publications as well. You try to cover it on a really nice way, considering also the various treatment options which we all have been dealing with, including the antiretroviral therapy, corticosteroids, or the COX inhibitors, and even the debatable, the hydroxychloroquine as well. And we also heard from you your insights about the sirolimus, the statins, and the various sepsis protocols. And you were very right in pointing about the settings which we should use, especially whenever we are putting such patients on those ventilators as well. Like, for example, how much is the oxygen saturation we should be targeting as well. And one of the key things which you really pointed out in a very nice way was that there is no US FDA approved treatment for such patients. Whatever treatment is being tried from the treatment of previous patients on a similar disease pattern, and otherwise the early patterns which has been observed from some of the countries like in China, and some emerging data which is also nowadays coming from the Italy and some other countries as well. So really, thank you so much. So I had some questions for you from our audience as well. How has been Egypt been trying to take care of such patients and all? How has been your experience in Egypt about the corona patients?
Thank you, Dr. Nareem, for your comments and valuable comments for me. In Egypt, the situation is under control. There's no outbreak up till now. Patients, when the WHO member was asked about why Egyptian people not affected so much with coronavirus infection, and he answered that there is underestimation of the number of patients because of most of them developed flu-like symptoms. They didn't come to stage 2 or stage 3. Most of patients were with flu-like symptoms or cold symptoms didn't manifest with severe symptoms. And some of the isolated medical staff, they were just positive without any symptoms. So a number of patients who needed mechanical ventilation and ICU admission were either late diagnosed or patient ignored their symptoms and they present very late to the medical advice. But most of Egyptian people didn't manifest with stage 3 or stage even 2B. Pulmonary infection with hypoxemia. The most of them are carrier of the virus without symptoms, and another variety is the flu-like symptoms. Only few needed mechanical ventilation, and also mortality is too low. Every day, Ministry of Health give a report about number of isolated patients whose PCR become negative, and the number is increasing every day. If we balance it, the number of disease, number of deaths, and number of recovered from positive to negative test, the most is a patient who recovered from PCR positive to negative. Most of these patients are carrier only, without any symptoms. So the condition is under control.
Okay.
Even, yes.
Yeah, please. Okay, that's really...
The government reduced the hours of restriction of movement. Every 2 weeks, it was up till 7 p.m., become 8 p.m., and during Ramadan, it was 9 p.m.
Oh, that's really good to know. Again, thank you so much for sharing those insights for the country. And what we have also been observing in the different countries, for example, in when we try to compare in China, most of those patients had been symptomatic, yes, there has been some data problems as well, data sharing problems as well. However, when we have been speaking to our colleagues in Italy, otherwise the patients which we are seeing, at least I am seeing in UK as well, we have been coming across most of those patients has been pretty symptomatic. But again, when we, as you said, it like even in Egypt, it seems a lot of patients are asymptomatic. Even when I was going through the data from the Indian patients as well, so it seems a lot of those patients has been asymptomatic as well. So maybe this is a newer trend which we are coming across in this corona patients. And there has already been newer theories which is going on. It seems as there are some different strains of corona patients as well, which we are coming across in the different parts of the world. So far, some scientists have came across, it seems, up to like 3 strains. So it definitely becomes more challenging for the physicians and also the healthcare professionals who are dealing with such patients to take care of them. And as you already shared with us about the different stages, so which really can be helpful in defining the strategy which should be used for such kind of patients. Dr. Mustafa, for convenience of all of us, would you like to summarize like what are those some criteria which we all should try to follow? Like, for example, if we have a corona patient in any of the wards, and when shall we shift them to a critical care or the intensive care unit?
Yes, this is a very important point. When to transfer the patient to the ICU management. And I said before that appropriate therapy should be given at appropriate time. So patient with respiratory rate more than 30 per minute and the heart rate more than 120 per minute, oxygen saturation less than 92%, should be transferred to the emergency room. And patient should stay in the emergency room until body temperature remain normal for at least 3 days. Respiratory symptoms are significantly improved. Chest X-ray or CT scan become improvement in the regions. No comorbidity or complication. And saturation become 90, at least 95 at room air without any assistance of oxygen. So 3 main criteria we should follow continuously in patient, especially high risk patient, is respiratory rate, heart rate, and oxygen saturation of room air.
Mm-hmm. Otherwise, even on a normal basis as well, in simple words, whenever those patients tend to become a little bit extra symptomatic, they are slightly bit unstable as well. Of course, they should always be considered as well. And we all have to be slightly bit extra cautious for those more vulnerable patients, especially those people who are having comorbid conditions like their diabetes, hypertension, who are more aged as well, especially if more than 70 patients. And now there are some studies as well, which has been also showing that ethnic minority people, they are, it seems, more predisposed for such comorbid conditions.
Yes.
Okay. Thank you so much, Dr. Mustafa, for sharing all the insights. We are really, really thankful to you. And I wish you the very best. And also, and I'm pretty confident the patients who are being getting treatment from the experienced hands of yours are also lucky. I wish you all the very best in the war against corona. Thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you, Dr. Nai.